Welcome everybody to 52 Living Ideas. So this is a series on Bucky inspired comprehensivity to understand and change the world. I'm honored to have Robert Sandusky here, and he's going to be talking about systemic design and CJ Fernley's four on ramps. The format is Robert is going to make some comments. Then there'll be brief, you know, you're welcome to make brief comments or questions. Keep track of all the questions or comments that you have using pen and paper. It's an amazing tool. Recommend it highly. And then after the Q&A, you know, a little bit of questions and comments, then there will be a second section, and then there will be more discussion. All right. So let's get started. Robert, the floor is all yours.
Thank you, CJ. Welcome to everyone. I'm glad to see all these faces. I'm going to start off with a story. And it goes like this. Once upon a time, you've heard it before. No, you haven't heard this version. So stand by. A long, long time ago, there was a being we now call, well, maybe it was Homo erectus, maybe it was Australopithecus, or maybe it was Homo habilis, the handyman. It really doesn't matter. What is important is one of these beings, and we'll pick up on Homo habilis. He's easiest to remember. It's easiest to remember. We don't know for sure that he was either or both and whatever. But let's say he's out taking a walk. He sees a varmint and wants to have lunch. He picks up a stone, throws it at the varmint, and of course misses. And it hits a rock and shatters into pieces. Shards all over the place. And he's upset, but he's also curious at all the shards. Some of them are glistening in the sunlight. He walks over and picks one up, and it cuts his hand. Well, he's kind of annoyed by that, but he licks his hand, and there's no damage done. So he looks at the shard, and he picks it up, and he turns it around in his hand, and he has an aha moment. This is an aha moment. This, he thinks, in his own language or the way they thought back then, this is something I can use back at the group. I don't even know if they lived in caves then. Some did, I guess, some didn't. But this will cut meat. If it'll cut me, it'll cut meat. So he takes it back to the group, and that's the beginning of the Stone Age. And also the birth of design. So we fast forward a million years, and give or take, and some being has done two unusual things. This is over a million year, or around a million years ago. And I saw these in exhibit at the British Museum in London. There were two artifacts. One was a handheld axe that was used as a handheld axe might be used. But the other one was interesting. It was a little bit bigger than a golf ball, and it was a spherical piece of quartzite that had been chipped away and had a lot of sharp edges on it all the way around. And they called it an orb. And I'm thinking, what good is an orb to those people when they're spending their time making hand axes? Well, I decided, no, that's not an orb. That's something else. That's got to be some kind of intentionally crafted, handheld, self-cleaning hide scraper. That was my conclusion. Of course, no one was there to listen to me or take my advice and have changed their ad. It's still an orb to this very day. However, fast forward a couple of million years, and I'm out with my friend, a ranch owner back in New Mexico, and we're looking for artifacts. This was one of our hobbies. And I came upon this rock that was in a stream bed, and it looks like this. It's rounded, kind of like that orb that I had seen. It's not faceted as much, but it looked very similar to this. However, the other side of it was all, undescribed. It was broken away. But playing around with it, you find out that there's a place for your thumb. There's a place for your finger and the other finger. And guess what? You've got your hand scraper, the same one that was in the British, not the same one, but the same idea that was in the British Museum a million years later. So what's the point here, huh? You look at the date, and science didn't show up until 3,000 years ago in Egypt and Mesopotamia. And by that time, design was 2 million years old. And the point is, design came way before science, and therefore it can't be called a part of science, nor can science claim to be the creator of design. Science can only claim to be, the beneficiary of design, because design is design, any way you look at it. Well, Wes Churchman, who I'm sure most of you have heard us talk about in the past, said more than once upon a time, many times, that the solution to a problem is in the problem statement. So for Churchman, it was essential to understand that systems are not natural phenomena, but they're mental constructs that we use elements and to put together elements and define relationships among them, and represent a boundary defined container, if you will, for those elements that produce an emergent outcome eventually. And that outcome is greater than the sum of its constituent parts, which, of course, we've heard before. The approaches to problems and systems can be described as in kind of three categories. Simplex issues, they're simple problems looking for a solution. All problems have a solution. They're there and ready and waiting. Well, Jean-Pierre Protzen and David Harris wrote a book about Horst Riddle. I have here. And they're talking about his theories on design and planning. And in this book, he has 8 steps for a systemic approach to design. And I'll just read off the problems or the steps. First, you got to understand the problem, gather information about the problem, analyze the information, generate solutions, compare the solutions, select a preferred solution, find an alternative that you like, and then implement the solution and test it before putting it into action. Well, I like to use this shell. I've done this before. Some of you have seen this before. I'm going to call this a snail shell. I know it's not. I don't know what it is, but snail shell will do. And you'll notice that, first of all, it's a very beautiful thing. It's almost perfectly formed. And it starts with this small beginning and gradually spirals out into the grand finale, which would be the emergence of the snail, probably after it was dead. But even the final boundary, this is the boundary of that snail system, is smooth and well crafted. It's a beautiful thing. Another category is the complex shell. And they're similar to simplex ones as to methodology, but they're more difficult to understand because they have complicated elements and contradictory inputs and are openly systems open to begin with, but later close in order to arrive at their solution. They basically have to constrict the inputs before they can come to a solution with a complex. And it can take a lot of time and a lot of effort because that shell looks like this. It's full of distortions and inputs and so forth that take away the simplicity, basically, and contribute to the composition and the difficulty in arriving at a solution. Usually at some point you come to an agreement or enough information has come to hand that you can go ahead and have your solution. Then the other kind is what we call indeterminate. And that shell looks more like this one. It's totally distorted in many ways, but it's still organized. It's beautifully organized, actually. This is a very pretty object. And all of these bumps in the shell represent all of the considerations, the inputs, the comprehensivity of knowledge that goes into this shell, and also distorts its position. It changes direction and complicates things to the point that there's, with an indeterminate system design, they're dynamic and they can't be simulated, they can't be prototyped, they can't be tested. And they're one of Horst Riddle's, what he calls wicked problems. And I'm sure you've all heard that before. In this book, he has 10 or so principles of wicked systems, wicked problems. And they're characterized by open systems, defined by the designer's judgment. The designer designs the system, and you have to make decisions as to what's going to be allowed and what you're not going to consider in that kind of a operation in defining the system. But they also remain open, so they have no end. There is no easy, there is no solution because of their change. They're constantly transforming. This is like a social system that does that. So you have to call it quits when you think you have enough information and enough effort with the design process to carry through with it. You never reach the final goal. The desired result is never fully reached. You're always playing the half the distance to the goalpost game. You'll never come up with the ideal, but every step that you take closer brings you closer to the ideal, and is, in theory, is an improvement. So, in conclusion, it would be drawn from this to recognize that not all issues are wholly containable. And infinite knowledge and understanding to be had is limited by practical aspects. Facts and design and knowledge are necessary, but not sufficient, and do not prescribe the action to be taken to achieve the desired outcome, which is in itself probably unattainable in its totality. So I'd like to open it up for comment if that works for you folks.
Wonderful. So folks, go ahead and type an exclamation mark if you'd like to ask any questions or make any comments. This is going to be a very interactive presentation. So go ahead, would love to hear your thoughts on design. You can talk about anything that you want. You can talk about, you know, the history of design. You can talk about the nature of systems as not being natural, but as a mental construct. You can talk about the simple, complex, and wicked problems. You can talk about the design process, anything that you want. Go ahead and type an exclamation mark if you'd like to make a comment. Or ask a question. Let's start with Rupali followed by Joe. Rupali, go ahead.
Thank you, Robert, for that journey through history. I really liked your story about the Homo habilis and how design is not a new idea, that ever since humans have been exploring their world around them, they've come up with these aha moments. That was really well said. And from going from the simplest shell to the more complex shell, the way you explained how problems can be from simple to complex to wicked problems, that was very helpful too. So, you know, in the 8 steps that you mentioned, could you elaborate a little bit about for the 8 steps in the design process? You listed them.
I didn't quite understand. Elaborate on what?
The 8 steps that you talked about of the design.
Oh, okay. Yeah. This is for simple designs, and it's used all the time. This is what I grew up with. Somebody states the problem. Now, let's take an example. My light bulb isn't working. The light went out. So that's your problem statement. And what you do is you go and you investigate the light bulb and you plug it into another light and it works. So it's not the light bulb. And then you go over to the switch and you try the switch and it doesn't make a difference. But the other light bulb goes on, so you know it's not the switch. You're going through this process of trying to find what you described was a burned out light bulb. And you can trace that systemically then as far as you want to go, clear back to the power company. Maybe circumstances were such that you were the only one on the line, which happens to us a lot where we live. But the point being that the problem statement encloses the problem within a system. And the only way you determine that it's not the light bulb itself is you have to go outside of that system, because the problem was the light doesn't work. Now you expand. Oh, she wanted to hear the, let me get some in front of me. First thing is to understand the problem. So if you say it's the light bulb, that doesn't necessarily mean that you understand the problem. That's what you define the problem as being. And so the solution is going to arrive out of the light bulb, not beyond it. So first thing is understand the problem. Then you gather information, which is what you do when you try the switches and so forth, to direct it towards the problem definition. The third thing you do is analyze the information. Am I giving you the wrong ones, or did you want the wicked problems?
No, this is the right one. Go ahead.
Okay. Because she said 9 and there are 10 wicked problem definitions. But anyway, you analyze the information that you've taken in. And in comprehensivity, the more information you take in, the more you have to analyze. But if you're only focused on the light bulb, you're not going to bring in information about what's happening with the transformer at the end of the block. Then you start to generate proposed solutions, alternatives. When I first went to work, they always, I worked for the Forest Service, and they always insisted that we come up with three alternative designs for whatever it was. If it was a pit toilet, they wanted 3 designs for a pit toilet. If it was a laboratory, they wanted 3 designs for alternatives. They wanted alternatives. So in doing that, you're defeating the purpose, because they're going to select one of the alternatives which they won't like, and then they'll pick and choose out of the other two and want you to put them together into the design of that they've kind of sort of like. So generating alternatives only works in simple systems where the alternatives are limited, closed system, and can be understood and constrained. Then you compare the solutions based on their merits. That's pretty straightforward. You select the one you like the best. And of course, in the instance I just showed you, it's always a combination, because you've learned more when you made 3 alternatives. You've learned more about the whole situation than you would if you just proposed one. Then you have to implement that solution and test it, and then go ahead and modify whatever is required on when you find problems with a solution. Now, the issue there is you have to have something in your hand. You have to have the problem solved before you can analyze it. So when you're dealing with indeterminate systems, you're dealing with something that doesn't exist in design. You're dealing with something that doesn't exist. It's not that you have something there's something wrong with. It's something that hasn't been invented yet, hasn't been conceived yet. So you aren't going to be able to prototype it and test it until you can bring it into existence. And you're not going to bring it into existence until you're ready and have the design complete. So I don't know, does that help?
Rupali, would you like to?
Yeah, it certainly helps understand how the design process works. And I think, you know, it's one thing that I really stuck out to me was you don't need to have so many alternatives. It works for simple problems. So why does it not work for complex problems?
When you have complexity, first of all, you have to still eventually close off the system because you can't keep entertaining information. In indeterminate systems, you don't even try to close it off. You limit it so you can operate with it, but you leave it open to inputs, because as you're going through the design process step by step, you will introduce more nodules into the shell, right? All of these little deals will present themselves as you're building the design process, as you're going through the rigors of figuring out the design. And they'll take you down different paths. You go so far and you'll run into an obstruction. In a complex system, the system itself may constrain you from trying to do things and think outside the box, do things that are not directly related to what you're putting together in the design. So it's important to understand that systemically, and this is synergetics, basically, that the more information you have, the more opportunities you have to work with, but you also have the issue of endless inputs. For instance, Harold, when he took a course in Harold Nelson took a course from Ritter, and Ritter asked his students to describe a match, and they set out, did this description. It went on virtually forever. And then I think the other thing he did was, after they were through with that, they had pages of descriptions. The deeper in and the broader they went, he asked them, describe what to do with the match. And the resultant was an action. This is a little bit different than what Harold told me. I'm making this one up. The action requires a different set of thought. It's no longer factual. It's no longer predetermined. You're working with the unknown, and the emergent quality is what's going to result with the action in that match. Now, don't assume that every time you strike a match, you're going to get fired. Because the matches I use sometimes don't ever ignite. You keep trying them and throwing them away. So presumption as to what the solution is going to be is not the way to go. You want to work with it based on the information you have, but you also want to let your mind work on it and conceptualize what might happen so that you have a better chance of setting off or restricting unintended consequences.
Wonderful. Thank you. Next up is going to be Laura. Laura, what's your question? Laura, you need to unmute. Okay, Laura, you're not able to unmute. Okay, let's go with Mike first. Mike, go ahead.
How do you best involve and motivate users and other stakeholders to participate in the process? One of the shortcomings I see is often you get into a mode where, now that I've given you exactly what I asked, what you asked for, let me tell you what I really want.
Yeah, good question. Well, now you're talking about large groups or groups of people, not a single client. So you have to approach, let's say it's a public, let's make it rather complex or complicated. It's a public issue. So you've got the vast public, you've got the interested public, you've got the public that's doesn't want it to happen, is uninterested, and you have your clients and your stakeholders. Let's say the client is, you know, the county or the city or whatever, and the stakeholders are the citizen. All those people have varying opinions and preconceived ideas and interests and so forth in what the design is. Well, many years back, they came up in California with the idea that you could create a volume of positive and negatives about a design. They're talking basically buildings and environmental designs. But the idea is you collect as much of that information as you can, knowing full well that you can't get it all. But you don't eliminate the opposition, you don't eliminate the negatives, and you create, at the beginning, you create a cohort that consists of experts, experienced people, ordinary citizens, politicians, doctors, lawyers, Indian chiefs. You create this cohort based on the needs of the particular design. And that cohort then can branch out into the community, into the stakeholders, into the users, and bring back information to the cohort, which gets integrated into the whole design process, rather than using the gather information and analyze the information and generate solutions. That's not what you're about. You're determining what the issue is before you take the steps towards designing a solution for it.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Robert, let me ask you one question. Yeah. Can you talk a little bit more about the wicked problems? What is a wicked problem?
Yeah. Wicked problems have been totally, bastardized over the years. And I'm going to get them out of here and just read them to you if I can find the place. Because they're rather obscure. Let me see. I don't think that's it. Okay. Now, this goes on forever, but I'll try to. I don't have a short list in front of me. So, a tame problem can be exhaustively formulated so it can be written down on a piece of paper, which can be handed to a knowledgeable man. Pardon me. That's not me. That's them. Who will eventually solve the problem without needing any additional information. This is not so with wicked problems. When I tell somebody the problem is that we need a management information system in our company, or whether to introduce a new product into our production line, I can write it down on a piece of paper, give it to him, and lock him up. But it will not be long before a person will come out again and ask for more information. Now, this is kind of beating around the bush. I thought he'd be more concise in this. The irritating thing is that depending on the state of the solution, the next question for additional information is unique and dependent on the state of the solution that you've already reached. The second property, in contrast to tame problems, is that every formation of the wicked problem corresponds to a statement of the solution and vice versa. When I say the problem is to get a machine carrying out 1 million operations, then this machine is a solution. If I say the machine should not be heavier than 500 kilograms, that's exactly the solution. This means that understanding the problem is identical to solving it. Whichever statement is made about the problems is a statement of solution. This is very difficult, very different from tame problems, where one thing is the problem and another the solution. It's very different from the notion of problems as the proponents of the first generation approach had in mind. Forget the one I just read before was the first generation approach to design. This goes on. There's 10 of these, and there come. I would suggest. No, wait a minute. There's 11 of them. I tell you what I can do at another date. I can summarize those for you and give them to me. I give them Absolutely. To you. I have them here, but they're not at my fingertips.
Sure, that's fine. Anytime, and next time you show up, I will ask you what's the wicked problem.
Deal.
Okay. Sounds good. Now it turned out that Joe had exactly the same question, and I guessed that that's what he was going to ask. So I asked it first. What are the wicked problems? So Joe, you'll have to wait till he comes back again.
One thing aside from the list, and that's not a very good one. I'm sorry I even brought it up. Wicked problems are problems that don't come with a built-in solution. Let's take a sociological issue, whatever it might be. If there was a simple solution, it would have long ago been found because it affects so many people. The situation is dynamic. It's always changing. And when you interfere with the existing system in a design, you're also tweaking the existent situation. So it changes as you tinker with it. Even just mental tinkering, when you produce a statement about the issue, you change that issue in the design when you're in the design mode. So the other thing about wicked systems is, you know, the half the distance to the goalpost problem. You're never going to have a satisfactory solution, but you're going to get closer as you go. That's good off the top of my head. I can do
thank
right
you.
Now.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Next up is going to be Maritza. Maritza, go ahead.
Hey, I was hesitant to ask this question, but since we're talking about wicked problems, I'm going to piggyback off of Mike's question, the idea of, I would view if we're looking at being designers of ourselves. So, you know, we're talking about designing systems. If we view the human a human life as a system that we are trying. So something that we've been doing here with 5211 Ideas is empowering the individual to view their life as a design process. So instead of drifting, we are all to pick up the mantle of designer. So inherently that would mean that our life by necessity has to be a wicked system, because, you know, we the judgment. So if we're dealing with a wicked system where judgment is such a high factor for changing the direction of what would be a potential solution, how do we mitigate the variety of potential outcomes? Like, how do you view something as more viable than another?
Yeah. Okay. And individual designing oneself is the hardest thing in the world to do, because yourself is invested in being a being of a sort that already exists, and it's integral to you. This isn't abstract. This is me we're talking about. And so you have to find a way for you to be able to self-analyze. And if you've gone through AA, you know what I'm talking about. Let me just use that as an example. And before you go to AA, you have to come to the realization that you need help. And once you do that, then you go to AA and they welcome you in and bring you in as part of the group, where you further employ investigate your personal weaknesses and needs and constraints. That becomes part of the design criteria. But as you're going through this process, you're also changing your life a little bit. It's tweaking you. And you've got support to help you restrain your habit. And that varies with every individual. But once you have reached a point where you can self-analyze enough to accept a change that would put you outside the box, you're outside your current box, then you can start working on how to do that and so forth. But it begins with this self-inquiry is really what it is. Why am I the way I am? And is that hard? That's virtually impossible, but it can be done. It can be done. And, you know, there are probably millions of people that can testify to the fact that it can be done. But let's assume that you're happy with yourself, sort of, for the most part. And you want to design a better life. And so you can go down the list and list all of the things that are unsatisfactory to you, that are giving you problems. And it's the same thing. You're gathering the information, sweeping in the information, doing the research, which is a scientific thing, but it's part of design. You do the research. Maybe you have a health issue that's involved, so you plug that in. You've got a relationship problem with someone, and you plug that in. And you assimilate those in a way that you can negotiate them. You have to be able to, like, not only be aware of them, but you have to be able to attack them and change them and modify them. Then, in a personal sense, you still need to go through outreach. You need to go to others to get feedback that you don't see. A lot of people have huge issues, personality issues that they don't even see. They don't realize they're insulting everybody every time they talk to them. And some people have, of course, mental issues that can't be handled alone. But going through this process, if you can do it, you can come up with the idea that, yeah, you know, I've got a problem here. I need to go talk to a psychiatrist and see if we can't work this out. So that's why I say that a single design of a life as a single life is, it's the worst. It's the most impossible thing to do, but it's also your decision all the way. So you will be designing what you want to do, what you're going to accept and what you won't accept and all of that. That's part of the process.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. The two things that really stand out about what you said, you know, one is that it all starts with accepting that you have a problem. You know, it's like without that, you can't do anything. Yeah. I think most people are in the situation where they just do not accept that there is a problem. And if that is the case, then you can't do anything. And the second is the crucial importance of feedback, because no matter how hard you try, you have all kinds of mechanisms to let you see only what you want to see. And this, just being honest and dealing with, you know, kind of dealing with people whom you trust and just hearing them out, that is a huge, huge thing. So I really like those two parts.
One other thing, it's not just people you like and get along with.
Yes.
It's that jester that I talked about the other day. You need to find a person that's not afraid to tell you that you're a jerk.
Yes.
Get over it, you know. And a lot of times, that triggers something that really works.
Yes.
I've seen it happen, so I know it works. But sometimes the ego is so distorted that, you know, medical professional attention is needed, warranted, and sometimes there's just nothing that can be done.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Next up is going to be Joe, Laura, and Paul. Joe.
So I like the idea, you know, where this idea is wicked, and we're talking about wicked problems specifically, how there's really no good answer with a wicked problem. There's only better and worse within that framework. So, I mean, I think about this in terms of like kind of many times in the health system, you know, that there are often trade-offs that you're going to be making. And you're just determining what's better and what's worse out of those situations. There's always going to be, you know, some things like, you know, some solutions are like, well, we'll fix prices, for example.
Yeah.
Well, you can fix prices, but there's going to be trade-offs within there. And what I see there is sometimes is there are conflicting values as well. And I think that that's another aspect to this that's really important to notice is that when you have multiple stakeholders, as Mike was mentioning, and you have conflicting values and how that actually can make a complex problem with an impossible answer. So where you only have better and worse, and you're balancing the fact of the stakeholders, you're balancing the interests of the stakeholders. And so at that point, that's where I look, that's how I define like kind of complex problems within a system is where, again, there's really no good answer and there's conflicting values and the trade-offs aren't even very clear to the individuals that hold the values themselves.
Okay, the other piece of that is what does not yet exist, what ought to be, which is where the design effort comes in, because you're working outside of the framework that's there. Let's take the hospital example. If you back up from what exists and say, what would we do if we didn't have this situation? How would we design? What would we do from the beginning to make things different than what they are? By taking that, it's an alternate route. And, you know, Harold had that thing about the trail most traveled, the highway most traveled. By taking that approach, you're opening up the whole opportunity. You're not wiping out what's there. It's what's there is there. But you're setting it aside and saying, well, let's start anew. We don't have a hospital. Nobody knows what a hospital is. What could it be? What should it be? How should we go about creating it? And of course, in real life, you're going to be referencing that back to the existing situation. But if you bound the system so you got to stay within the existing system, you're never going to get out of it. So you open it up and let information and data and ideas flow in and trigger conceptions in your minds, plural minds and minds of the cohort and so forth, that may come up with ideas that turn into approaches that are totally different than you would have come up with if you'd stayed within the system.
Joe, you had a follow-up.
I think that that's an incredibly important point because you're starting with the ideal in that particular instance. And you're thinking outside the constructs of the systems, because many times what people do when they look at problems is they'll immediately go to metrics or they'll go to analyzing data about what already exists, as opposed to taking into the what is not in existence, coming up with an ideal state to address the problem itself. And so that's one of the things that I see as a distinction sometimes between Harold, you know, he starts with the ideal state more times than not that I've seen in his presentations, Whereas some people actually start with the problem itself. And that with a wicked problem becomes very difficult, because then you're kind of just, it's just more risk analysis at that point, more than it is actually coming up with a solution.
You said it better than I did. And the other thing is, the wicked problems, and we'll get that list, but you go around it instead of through it. You don't try to approach it as if that's, you know, your boundary. You set that aside. It's real, so you're going to live with it. But you take an approach, like you said, that goes outside of that towards what the ideal ought to be and work in that direction.
Thank you. Our next up is going to be Laura. Laura, can you go ahead and unmute, please? Okay. No? Okay. Next up is going to be Paul. Paul, go ahead.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
The thing you just said is related to the way I'm thinking about this, which is we talk about wicked problems as not having the solution in the problem, but is it fair to frame it differently that if you change the what you might call the meta framework that you're using to analyze, then the solution is in the problem. So no situation is inherently wicked. The example I would give back to psychotherapy is, you know, there's all these approaches. There's the psychodynamic approach where you're going back to your childhood. There's dialectical behavior where you're in the moment with mindfulness. There's cognitive behavioral where you're looking at, you know, you're looking at thought challenge and contradictions in your thinking. But my point is, if you look from one of those spaces, you have a wicked problem, but from another space, you do not. So as part of your process, changing the meta analysis framework to make the wickedness go away.
Well, I don't know that you can make the wickedness go away, but if you come up with a design that's outside of the framework of the wicked problem, it doesn't exist. You've got to create it, and then you may have something that brushes the wicked problems aside. And it's very hard to come up with an example when we're talking about that, but I'm trying to come up with something.
Let me give an example. My favorite example from Russell Acuff.
Yes.
it's just amazing example of, you know, there was this inner city school where people were having such great difficulty getting kids to learn to read. So it's like it was almost impossible. And then Russell Acuff goes in there and tries to figure out, because most people, what he found out was that parents of most of these people also did not read. They didn't have books at home. Most of the interaction that they had with people was verbal. And there was really no reason that they had to learn. So what he did was that in cafeteria, he started playing Charlie Chaplin movies with subtitles. And it was silent movies with subtitles. And and the rule that they had was that any kid who wanted could leave the classroom and go to the cafeteria to watch these movies anytime they wanted. And the kids started to read because they really wanted to know what was going on. So it is a very deep, wicked problem. That's my favorite example.
Getting out of the framework of a wicked problem is what's difficult, and you have to allow yourself to just basically be a dreamer and come up with ideas about what ought to be. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. But if you stay within the boundaries of the wicked problems, that's where you're gonna stay. That's where you'll remain. Did you want to say something else, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, does the, in the psychotherapeutic realm, does this apply or not, Srikant and Rob? Like, a person has a impulse control problem.
Yeah.
And so you apply a therapy X, like cognitive behavioral, but then somebody goes, hey, if we hook a bunch of electrodes to his head and train his neurofeedback so that he tries to suppress alpha waves from this electrode, his impulse control goes away. I mean, is that an example of what I'm talking about?
That's an example of a scientific technological solution.
Two different ones that are completely different systems. I think part of it is the whole infrastructure we have in the world doesn't even allow for that, you know?
Yeah, yeah. But I wasn't finished, and it's fine what you're saying. It's a technological solution, but it's thinking outside the box. You're not trying to work one-on-one or manipulate the person's mind from interpersonal contact and suggestions and all of that. You found a technology that'll do the job for you, and that works. But somebody somewhere had to come up with the idea that plugging those things into that part of the brain gets this part of this kind of reaction. And the danger is you plug it into that side of the brain and it works and screws up something else on the other side. There's the emergent quality that can be negative as well. But you're right on. If you don't think outside of the interpersonal relationship, you may not find a solution.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. One thing that when we went through Kurt's slides about system change ideas that Bucky had, he said there are three things you can do. One is that you can use a trim tab approach where, say, where is the point of maximum leverage? The second approach is to systematically study the interactions between systems. In this case, you're saying, oh, kids actually like movies. That's part of it. It is a system which is actually operative here. Can I use that? And the third one is to create a new system. It's like, okay, is there something wrong with the education system itself? And what do we do with, so it's kind of, stepping back and doing that. Let's take one last question, and then we're going to go to the next part, second part. Rupali, go ahead.
So this is not so much a question, but an observation. Sure. We had studied an autobiography of an idea by Louis Sullivan and Kindergarten Chats. And in there, he explains this idea of how do you approach a problem, which is very similar to what we said, understand it. And what you said, Robert, about what the solution ought to be. And Louis Sullivan says that very well in Kindergarten Chats. Don't go to the old forms, look at the function and create your own forms based on what the problem, the function is, the solution that you're looking for. And he also says the problem, if there's a problem, there's a solution in it too. So I just think that all these designers have thought about approaching design in a holistic way, in a more idealistic way than just fixing the problem on the surface. I just wanted to share that observation. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Rupali. All right, Robert, shall we proceed to the second part?
Okay, but I've forgotten where we left off. Here we go. Okay. This may bother some people, so take notes. In his quest to understand Bucky's comprehensivity, CJ proposed the four on-ramps to synergetics. And Srikant gave us a video introduction to that, an open invitation to Bucky Fuller's inspired comprehensivity, and it was great, by the way. And with that video, Shrikant had the four tetrahedrons, and each one representing one of the four on ramps, basically. And I'm going to, you know, those four on ramps incidentally had multiple meanings, but I'm going to take the ones you use, which were collaboration, integrity, design, and science. The tetrahedron of mine's going to fall apart, so I got to put it back down. But you know what I'm saying. It's my understanding in CJ, one of CJ's essays, he was talking about hoping to provide a way for people to enter into comprehensivity. And that's where he came up with the idea of the four on-ramps to appeal to different personalities and worldviews, or in some cases, there's four of them, but you might identify with all three and be willing to approach it more so than if you just throw the thing out there. I guess that's what I got from his, that they would find resonance with one or more of the on-ramps and be willing to join in the dialogue. Well, Bucky's terminology in his writings of design and science should be about design and science being separate. He uses design science almost as if it's one word, and the on-ramps, they're two different things. And in my way of thinking, with the design background, design and science are not one and the same. And it's fundamental that design and the human effort have to be understood with the four cultures, science, design, humanities, and spirituality, which is a religious belief side of life. So these cultural qualities that I just rattled off there are the connectors in the tetrahedron, and or the points of the tetrahedron, and the toothpicks or the connectors, that's the passing of information all around. And you notice, and this has all been pointed out before, but Bucky shows that each of these connected points is connected directly to each of the others. So what he's saying is what Wright described when he folded his hands and said, integration. This is integration. And then there are four, in this case, four things, four cultures integrated. We know that issues arise because all systems are not put together in a form bounded like that. And you pull one of those connections apart and the form loses all of its ability, its strength, and its wholeness. I wanted to read an excerpt from one of CJ's essays on comprehensivity. The comprehensive anticipatory design science revolution designates the thread in Buckminster Fuller's philosophy that emphasizes the need to radically reorient humanity's problem-solving efforts by the employment of the practice of science in a comprehensive and anticipatory fashion toward the design of effective solutions to better meet the needs of 100% of humanity. The emphasis is on the design of comprehensive solution, one that works sustainably because they have anticipated comprehensively all the factors relevant to the problem space. And then we go to this and we see that all of those complications are integrated in the indefinite, indeterminate system, but they get worked out through the process of going through the system, acknowledging, understanding, and using them appropriately. In honor of CJ's aspiration there, I'd like to offer a metaphor to consider about the on-ramps. And let's think of it as the highway of comprehensivity and synergy. That's the freeway. And we're preparing to take a ride on the freeway. So the first thing you have to do is preparation. And I'm going to bring this thing up from the past too. But preparation here is one of the, does that read?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. In preparation, you know how to drive, you have a license, you have insurance, you've had considerable driving experience, so you're able to take on the challenge. And that's your core, which is your base, your confidence, your basically the guarantor that you're able to be a driver and that you should be driving on a freeway. But before you leave, you check with your passengers and verify where you're headed and why you're headed there. And the best route that you would take and what your expectations are on arrival. And this is your engagement and preparation part of the process. All this is prior to entering on the freeway. So as you exit the on-ramp, you're now in the traffic and it's stop and go, not unexpected, but you must decide where and how you're going to merge. And this would be part of the emergence phase. Immersion phase, I'm sorry. And you have to pick which lane you're going to go on. You have to maneuver in and out of the traffic and so forth. That's all decisions that you're making on the move in the dynamics of the system. Your map device tells you what might be waiting ahead to cause a traffic backup that you're engaged with. So you factor that into lane choice, adjusting your arrival time and your passengers, notifying their whoever they're dealing with that you're on your way, but you're going to be delayed. But in the meantime, you notice that the gas gauge is approaching empty. So you've got to get off. You take an off ramp and you go to a service station, but it's closed. So you have to search around for a place to buy gas. Now you're off away from the freeway, away from your original direction and your original path, but you eventually find a place where you can buy your gas. So from there, you feed forward to the next on-ramp that you can find. And in this phase, you're in divergence. You're bringing in new information, totally new surroundings, and dealing with something it has nothing to do with what you were doing on the freeway. So you get your tank full and you find another entryway to the freeway. And after you consult the map, you see there's this side frontal road that you can take. It's an option. You can either go back on the freeway or take the side route, the route less traveled, the fronted road. You take that, and sure enough, you bypass the whole obstruction. You get back on the freeway, and you're ahead of where you've been, where you would have been had you stayed on the freeway. So the diverted bifurcation you've taken comes up with the result and outcome, which was in this case intended, but was modified several times along the way. And once back on the freeway, you're ahead of the construction, and you get at your arrival time, you take the off ramp, and you've achieved the intended purpose of the trip. So the moral of this metaphor is this trip started out as a simplex problem, developed into a complex problem very quickly, and then the objective was achieved and issues were overcome. The outcome was different than the intended one, but it was acceptable. So simplicity and comprehensivity is without much merit because nothing was done to perfect the freeway, the conditions on the freeway. The greater problem was not solved. Your immediate problem was solved, but it only involved that which basically was constrained by the automobile itself. So nothing had been provided in the whole system by your adventure that affected the future of the highway in any way. There was one less auto that impacted the backup, but that was it. So I'd like to hear your comments about that metaphor.
All right. I love metaphors. So because the thing about metaphors, so let's talk about metaphors as such for a couple of minutes. Metaphors are very, very interesting things, because what you're trying to do with metaphors is that you're using something that you're more familiar with in order to understand something that you're less familiar with. So you're using, you know, the thing, this is Julian Jayne's terms of metaphors. Metafear is something that you know, like cars going on ramps and off ramps, you know. Exactly how do these different functions operate in conjunction with each other? We don't know that well. So we use something that we know in order to deal with something that we don't know. And what happens is that each of them have got, each metaphor has meta, you know, paraference. That means they have like associated things with it that actually try to capture much more richer nuances of things that you don't know. Like to give you an example is that when you say that snow blanketed the earth, the direct metaphor you're using, the tool that you know, is a blanket on the bed. The metafriend is the snow on the ground. But the parafriend is that it gives you a sense of warmth, that this is, earth is sleeping and it's going to wake up with spring. And all of that is carried. So when you compare different metaphors. So let's make this discussion even more interesting. This is wonderful, Robert. So I'm going to throw in two different metaphors, two other metaphors here, and let's drive all these metaphors in parallel and try to understand how these four on-ramps work, you know, four approaches work. One metaphor that you can use is in terms of a rope. It's four different colored ropes coiling with one another, making it stronger, supporting each other. They remain separate. In this metaphor, they remain separate. They have their own nature, but they support each other, making them together much stronger than they would be by themselves. Take another metaphor of river flowing, where there are rivulets of different color coming in, mixing into the river, and then separating out into streams to irrigate other land. So you have these different colors mixing, producing something which is actually a hybrid, that each is picking up something from the other, and then it is again separating out. It is things adding to the river, making it stronger. And then that same water going out to irrigate lands in specialized way, and then coming back again to join the river. So there is that. You can look at it as a river metaphor. So there is a river metaphor, there is a traffic metaphor, and there is the rope metaphor. So let's open it up for just discussion, because what we are really talking about is these four functions, the functions of, you know, the thought of coming up with a geometry, coming up with the principles that are governing things. That's, let's call it the blue part, which is, or the science part. Then there is transformation of the world that we'll call green. You're trying to design things. Then there is the love between people, the regard between people that allows for collaboration together. Let's call it red. And then there is this intuitive grasp of what is it all about? What is the spirit of it? The spiritual integrities that you're trying to get at. That's the yellow. So, and how do these four things interact with one another within a person and between people? How do they actually do that? Now, that's a very difficult thing to understand, because it is in our consciousness. It is in a society. Social things are difficult to understand, more difficult to understand than physical things. They're far more difficult to understand than ropes, water, and road systems, okay? So we have to keep our eye on both the social and what happens within us. And let us talk about all these metaphors and see which of them have the right combination. Maybe we can come up, people can come up with more metaphors to describe this. You can take this one, for example. You can look at this as a four, as a tetrahedron, but you can see that it has a center towards which, from which it can grow in multiple directions. And you can have an irregular tetrahedron, which has different proportions, with one of them more advanced than the other. So you can look at this as another metaphor. So we got four metaphors here, and would love to hear, but keep your eye focused on what do you think is actually going on within a person and between people. And let's use all these metaphors. I would love to hear what you guys say. Does that make sense, Robert, to ask that? Okay, folks, go ahead and type an exclamation mark if you would like to talk about metaphors. How do you think about this? How do you think about the four on-ramps? You can just start talking if you want. No, this is a very difficult, you know, Robert, thank you so much for bringing this question up, because, you know, it is a very complex thing. And it is a wicked problem of how does it work? This is a classic example of a wicked problem. And would love to hear what anybody has to say about this. We're going to start with Joe. Joe, go ahead.
All right. This is kind of diving into the deep end a little bit. When I initially saw, CJ's four on-ramps, I saw a lot of similarities to that and the orient phase within the OODA loop, where it actually includes cultural traditions. It includes new information, previous experiences, analysis and synthesis, and genetic heritage. So it includes a lot of the same things. Now, it doesn't include a lot of the analytical aspects of it, some of the geometrical aspects of it, but that you can almost say is inferred in a way.
Let us do one thing, because people are not, we can't assume that they're familiar with OODA loop. So let me go ahead and summarize the OODA loop. OODA loop is an idea that John Boyd came up with. It has four phases. One is that of observation, taking in data from it. Okay, that is kind of, so that's one. Second is orientation, of trying to put it together, of saying, okay, what is this? The third is to decide what you need to do. And fourth is acting. Go ahead.
And yes, so it's basically, and then there's the feedback loop that you keep coming in, that it's kind of reinforcing. And then I see that similar to the ropes that you were talking about, in the sense that how everything is, and you're constantly reassessing things as well. And that's what I see is almost anticipatory design in a way, because you're kind of anticipating the next step in the design process. We are reorienting continuously. So that I saw, that's where I look. I thought of, when I looked at CJ's four metaphors, and I'll put a photo or a link to the OODA loop so people can be a little bit more familiar, but I saw a lot of similarities between those two. That's just my first comment.
Thank you. Thank you, Joe. Folks, go ahead and type exclamation mark if you'd like to comment. I'll say one thing. One of the more interesting aspects of this dance of using Robert's metaphor, it's comprehensive. It's kind of comprehensivity and specialization. You have to have ramps that come in, and you need to have comprehensivity, and then you need to go out and apply to the specific fields. So there is this dance going on continuously between moving towards comprehensivity and moving towards specialization. Bucky calls it, it is going kind of broad, macro comprehensive, and micro incisive. And you are using, when you're taking off ramp, you are going in that micro comprehensive direction. And when you're coming back onto the comprehensivity, you're bringing it together. It's like breathing in and breathing out. You're breathing in to try to take in more things, and then you're breathing out to say something. That's your expression of it. So there is this continuous dance going on. You can't keep breathing in. You can't keep breathing out. You need to use both of them. The cars have to come onto the highway. The only way they can keep coming onto the highway if they're going out. And they can't be going out unless they're coming in. Next up is going to be, I'm going to go to Richard, and because Richard is more familiar with this. And then we'll go to Paul. Folks, go ahead and type an exclamation mark. Richard, go ahead.
Thank you. It's been an on and off ramp already this evening for me, because I was on the road for the most part and have just come back in. What's interesting for me in terms of the metaphors, but also in the reference to just what was being said in terms of the four phases, and I think what Robert was getting at too, was a for me, the notion of four patterns, how things are interconnected with each other. And so when I work off of the tetrahedron, then I tried to figure out a way to combine pattern and phases, or systemic and systematic. And so often we stick with the systematic because that's kind of what we've been taught, the linear eight steps or the four steps. And so how do we then find a way to integrate systemic with systematic? So you go along the road with your systematic sort of process, things happen that, as Robert was explaining, and then you have to switch back and reassess the pattern that you're in. And when you reassess that pattern, that may change the methodology or some aspect of the methodology. So you're always going between systematic and systemic, or vice versa, which is another way of saying, I guess, you're going between concave and convex. It's always that there's two things minimally that are always interacting. You can't separate them. If you're doing one, you've got to be doing the other. The other thing that's kind of interesting for me is that in suicide prevention work, we have used the road metaphor, and we've done it on the basis similar to what Robert was talking about, that you're going down the road of life and there's a bifurcation that takes you to the down ramp and takes you into that area of not wanting to live, let's say. And then what do you do to make a turning point so that you can find another on-ramp and come back on? And it may in fact be exactly what Robert was talking about. The on-ramp that you finally get back on has actually got you past an obstacle that you either were anticipating or you had faced before, like the traffic jam, but now you bypassed it and carried on. So it's really fascinating to be able to use the metaphors, but my worry is that we end up using one or the other. We think in patterns or we think in phases and not the two together. So that's my kind of sense of the phase and pattern linkage to the metaphor of a roadway.
Can you elaborate on the distinction between phase and pattern again?
Well, for me, it's a pattern is when you see a network of, say, four nodes in a network, so that you see the nodes and the six interconnections if you're using a tetrahedron. And so you see it in a pattern form. But when you turn that pattern into a systematic way, you then have to change the model and make it look like the four phases, like one phase, two phase, three phase, four phases. And so you could draw it so you can see a pattern, maybe even just like a spider web if you want. And then the methodology can show you the linear phase by phase.
So it's steps. Sequential versus parallel is what you're talking about?
Well, it could be, yes. For those who, and I can see them right here, that are into spirals. Yes, I think the spiral very often has to do with pattern. And in fact, today I found a wood carving spiral that told me that its origin comes from the Maori people in New Zealand. So I've taken a photograph of it, and I had an audience in mind that I was going to send it to. I didn't realize I'd see them so soon.
Wonderful.
They have a gift that's on their way.
Wonderful. Thank you. Next up is going to be Paul, followed by John. Paul.
Yeah, thanks for this enlightening talk about metaphors. I've been sort of striving, I should say, to find my own model for to apply the Bucky concepts since you started these, Srikant, but I want to say where I am with that, which is it might be useful to think about the model of energy systems and energy net gain and net loss and take this fundamental idea that there a four-pointed structure in 3D space is fundamentally important and fundamental in the universe, and also you need it to be capable of generating more energy than you need to survive. So, but the point I'm making about this is, I find it hard to map those, what those four things are internally in me as a human, in each person, to what a social system needs. So it's actually the fundamentalness of the shape that's important, but you might use different concepts for each point for where you are in the overall system. So within me, the four points are more related to things that aren't about design and science. But then if I have a strong, robust, four-pointed health system, then I am capable of, like when you have an electrical system in a house, you can give energy back to the electric company if you are making more with your solar panels than you need. So I can then give out to a neighboring node, which I'm in a four-pointed structure with, energy, and that four-pointed structure, those four points signify something different, because that's a social structure. And when that is there, it can generate, as a node, things. So I'm just providing another metaphor with the energy net loss addition and the idea that the four points are flexible as to what they mean, depending on the context. Thank you.
Absolutely, Paul. I mean, Bucky thinks exactly like this. This synergetics has a lot of ideas just like this. Kirby works a lot on this, and I'm sure many of the folks here do. Thank you. Next up is going to be John, followed by Laura. John and Yoshimi.
Thank you. I have to go a little bit further away. Yeah, so here's an example of, here's a pattern that you can see. And so when we want to do a sequence, what we've chosen to do with emergently, which we used to call tetrameme, is we do a spiral. So we go from one triangle to another and then around like this and out, perhaps again. And the way that I conceptualize this is that these triangles represent actually something much more dynamic. And I'm going to show you another version of it with people. So when you see that this tetrahedron like this, you can see a very distinct sequence happening here. But we could shift these people into different orientations. Notice this one is there's one upside down here, but you could do them differently. So that the original spiral, if you map it onto a tetrahedron, it can be in any direction. So you lose that sequence. So the idea of a sequence is only because that's how it happens sometimes. It's an instant. It's the time space where the time is really important. And this is the time space where the space is really important. And we have to remember that both are always occurring at the same time. And this is a much better model. But because we can't visualize it, it's just easier to visualize it like this. Exactly. And Shimi's got that too.
I can't not talk. When we created TetraMap, what I just realized in listening to this is what we do as facilitators is to go from linear or phases to patterns. And we go from linear binary thinking for understanding, and then go, voila. And usually people are quite excited about the dynamics of this. It's always dynamic. What we're trying to shift mindsets, it's a dynamic process. Yeah.
So that picture is a nice linear picture, but when you put it into a tetrahedron, it then becomes more realistic and actually becomes infinite. And so we have to remember with our mental models, we tend to use, you know, static patterns, and then we tend to do linear paths or spirals. But actually they're meant to the reality is that they often happen in different sequences, but mentally it's really useful to understand them in a particular sequence. It's much easier to understand them, and it's much easier to remember this pattern than it is to remember this pattern.
Wonderful. Thank you, John. Thank you, Yoshimi. Next up is going to be Laura, followed by Mike. Laura, go ahead. Can you unmute?
Go ahead. I'm listening very hard at all of this. And of course, I think to what we do in school and what we learn and what we don't learn. And I think, you know, school only does linear thinking, basically. And I was thinking when you were giving out some information, you know, when you were talking about the simplex and the steps, you know, Polyev model is sort of, you know, a takedown from that. And that's what we focus on in school, if at all, you know, and it's a very simple linear way of thinking of solving a problem. And at best, we learn that. So most of the people that you deal with cannot think about what you're thinking about. Even if you made it ultimately the most transparent thing in the world, it would still be the most, you know, wild thing, you know, unbelievable thing. So how do we begin with learning to do much of introducing these ideas that there are, you know, different ways of looking at things and infinite ways of thinking about things, or that you have this linear model, but when you do this, we can make it an infinite way of looking. How can we have to begin to inculcate these ideas early on so that, you know, you don't have to go through graduate school and a master's degree to start thinking like this, because basically nobody's thinking like this when they think about these problems. You know, I'm going to get on that damn ramp and I'm going to do this and I'm going to blow the horn till they let me and I'm going to squeeze in. That's the way people are thinking. They're not looking, oh, I'll analyze this and I'll think, oh, and I'm going to, you know, and they go, God damn it, I got it. Oh, no, now I got to go find gas. God damn it. You know, oh, wow. Well, it turned out okay, I guess. But, you know, we were just lucky. And it's not like, oh, this was a really nice way of solving this problem of gas. You know, so we don't do that. So how can we get to the point where our thinking has to be, you know, taken down to a point where we begin to think like this early on, where we have problems where kids think like this, and it's okay to think like this. And, oh, look at this, and look at that, and now let's compare these solutions, and how does this work? And wow, you know, look, we have to use these tetrahedron models, because these are the most beautiful models in the world to see these things, because it's, you know, we can see this, you know, we can see 10-12 space now, oh my gosh, you know, and I can't write it down, but I can see it for once. And got to do this. Now, how do you do it?
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Laura. Really appreciate that. Thank you. Let's see. Next up is going to be, go ahead. Next up, Robert, you wanted to say something?
Well, about what Laura was talking about, you know, children, when they're small, don't think linearly. They use their whole brain. They think globally, or at least the kids I know do. And then we take them to school and we teach them to think linearly so they can read. And there's nothing wrong with doing that. But in the process, I think early on, we begin to take away their global perspective and try, because mathematics is linear. I mean, you know, in the learning process early on, and language is linear. So that has been a problem. But, you know, now they're looking at TV, at video. And video isn't linear. It's not only nonlinear, it's also dynamic. It's constantly changing. And that has an effect as well. In that, you know, there's the 10-second sound bite and instant gratification and all of that that goes along with this. And if you're going to think in abstraction, you can't do it in a nanosecond flash thing. It's an abstraction, takes time, but it's not necessarily linear. And if it is linear, you can also learn to flip the triangle and flip the the big triangle into a trapezoid. But that, like Laura says, that's not being taught now. And it involves kind of undoing some of what's happened in the past and what's going on concurrently today.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Next up is going to be Mike, followed by Richard. Mike.
The big advantage to systems that are linear, at least well-behaved, is you can take derivatives of them. And the derivatives point to either whether you take them analytically or implicitly in your mind, the derivatives point to a goal function that you could see which direction is going to improve it. And that you can solve those kinds of problems. And those are the problems that most scientists and engineers solve. An example of something that is wicked is coming up with the COVID-19 vaccine. That was a wicked problem. Not only did we require new technology, but the problem is highly unanalytically testable, not well behaved, discontinuous, and sensitive to initial conditions and external influences. In addition, that once you came up with an answer and got most people inoculated to it, you created an environment where the virus was going to change. And it changes in a kind of predictable way. And that's in the mathematical sense, which I guess Riddle lived in that world, theory of design. It's called an emergent property. So these emergent properties require a higher level of thought to be able to predict them, or you just wait till they occur and you react to them. Another thing is instead of real calculus to do the goal function, you have to do tensor calculus because your decision space is changed by your solution.
Wonderful, so, thank you.
Variant and a whole list of other things. And the COVID-19 was an example of that. What they're doing, trying to do right now to control inflation.
Thank you, Mike. I don't want to go too far. That's a good example, thank you. Next up is going to be Richard. Richard, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. I was just one quick story before I go into something else here, but I was working with a group of child welfare people years ago. Some were not indigenous people, some were non-indigenous. I was using a 3D model, a tetrahedron model. And as I was talking about it in the course of the morning, I could see eyes glaze. And those eyes were largely the non-Indigenous people. When we went for lunch, one of the Indigenous child welfare workers came to me and said, "I know exactly what you're talking about because that's how we think." And that's when I realized that in some ways, for some people, they will get it three-dimensionally. They'll understand it. They have trouble then laying it down into a linear form. And other people are comfortable with a linear way, and it's hard to turn it into a nonlinear or like a holistic way. Now, if we take the models that John and Yoshimi were presenting, and you take those four triangles and you multiply by dividing at the midpoints, you'll end up with four little triangles in each of the four. Then you can turn three of them around, the bottom three, let's say, And you can put them into different kinds of patterns so that you see the four corners and you can stretch them a little bit and you'll see the six inner relationships. So you've got a systemic pattern with those three triangles, but now you want a systematic pattern, a phase-like pattern. So you take the top triangle and what you can do is either fold it behind or over top and you will see three. You could take the top and fold it to one end or the other and you'll see four. And so what I concluded out of this is that when you're working in a linear phase-like sort of system, you can have as many as you want and as many steps as you want, but you cannot go less than three or four. In other words, it's like a beginning, a middle, and end in a book. You've got to have at least three or four, and the linear model of that is actually tied back to the tetrahedron. So it's so that's how I have worked in my mind with turning the four planar triangles, the way they showed them, into a combination of three patterned models and then one systematic model. And the other thing that I found, and I think it's been referred to already, is that if that common structure was understood, then you can load it with whatever information you want. You can load it with the kind of information that John and Yosha may use. You can load it with the information that I use. You could load it with the highway metaphor kinds of information. In other words, you could load it with engineering information, with social studies information, with geology information. And at the end of the day, if we could all understand that, then we'd realize that the manifestations of different disciplines, sciences, whatever, are all tied to the same common framework. And so you then have a respect for commonality and diversity. They go together. Anyway, that's how I've been using the tetrahedron to try and make sense out of it in terms of the work and experiences that I've had.
Excellent. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Richard. Next up is John. John, go ahead. John and Yoshimi.
Hi, just real quickly on top of what Richard said, the most expansive, powerful uptake of TetraMap has been with our Maori population here in New Zealand.
Indigenous people.
Our indigenous people. And this is what they call Te Ao Maori, which is Maori worldview. So when we presented TetraMap to Katarina Pipi in 2003, she came to our first certification course. Her partner thought he was coming to a course on TetraPak. He didn't have any clue what he was coming to. But Katarina in 20 years has taken this and it is totally immersed in Te Wānanga Aotearoa, which is the Māori University. And yeah, that's all I need. Because it resonates, it makes sense. And we've been struggling for 20 years to teach it to white people. And they love it because it's fun.
Mara's got it straight away.
But they don't get it. They do not get it. They do not understand the power of the tetrahedron. They think it's a fun little icebreaker. But Māori just, so I know there's a way for us to work with indigenous because we don't have to explain. They just get it. Yeah.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Yoshimi. Next up is, Robert, what do you think of all the comments? I don't know whether we went through everything that you wanted to. Please, any comments, Robert?
My comment is I'm loving this. This because just think what we've gone through in the last few minutes, all of the diversity that's been spinning around, different views, different ways to think of abstract and non-abstract issues, psychological. It's pretty Fantastic. In such a short time, what, half hour?
Yes. Yes. Wonderful. All right. Let's see. Does anybody have any more comments about the metaphor? Otherwise, I'm going to tell you what's actually, let's take the time. So firstly, thank you, Robert. What I want to do, folks, go ahead. Robert had something. Robert, yeah, go ahead. Let me just set this up first. So Robert is going to make some concluding comments here. And then I'm going to tell you about the plan for, I want to talk about, this has been 2 months. This meetup completes 2 months of the Bucky meetups. I want to take a review of that. I want to get feedback from you guys about how we're doing, what we're doing right, what we're doing wrong. I've also brainstormed with Maritza, Joe, and Rupali about what we are going to do in Q2. So I want to talk to you about that and get your feedback, get your comments on that as well. But Robert, go ahead.
I just had a couple of things that I wanted to throw out going forward here. To think about the application of complexity, the breadth and depth of facts and truths, then how do you design a boundary for that system? And knowing that it will be limiting and not all inclusive. And then how do you handle exclusions from that system? Going forward, how do you then dare to take on systemic design issues that are indeterminate? Knowing that the outcome won't be perfect, how do you prepare for emergent outcomes? They're not good ones. What approach do you take to achieve desired outcomes that are novel and cannot be substantiated as true until they become real? Those are just some ideas to play around with.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Really appreciate it. So folks, now let's look back at these 2 months and let's look forward. March is already set. I've got a whole bunch of next Sunday. It's going to be Christopher Zeloff, the meetup that we missed because of tech problems. He's going to be coming back. He's going to be talking about cinematic themes in Bucky. The weekend after that, that's March 12th, we're going to do the lightning round, where everybody gets to come and talk. Anybody who wants is welcome to talk for about 5 minutes on any topic. It doesn't matter how well you know Bucky, and even if you don't know Bucky, that's fine. You could just come and talk about ideas, and then we'll have a general discussion. And the last weekend, March 17th, I'm just honored to have Kurt McNamara. He's going to be presenting the book. He's writing a book on Bucky as designer, and he's going to be actually doing meetups on chapters as he writes them. So the first chapter, I think it is going to be on tuning. So that's going to be on March 17th. And each month, once a month, he will come on the third Sunday of each month to present his next chapter. CJ did exactly that. And that was one of the reasons his book got done. And I'm hoping that Kurt's book gets out 6 months earlier as a result of this. Plus, he will get valuable feedback. Writing is a lonely profession. This is a great way of getting the feedback. Also gives the deadline, which is also a very good thing for writers. Anybody who has written will know that. So I think it's going to work very well. So that's going to be on March 17th. And that's another part that is going forward through the rest of the year. Then on March 24th, we're going to have Richard, coming back, and he's going to be talking about social tensegrity. So I'm really, really looking forward to that. So that's March. So now I want to tell you about the April. What, I I thought about this quite a bit. And I watched a whole bunch of videos by Bucky. And I have to tell you, Bucky as a thinker is just incredibly deep. And I don't think we have begun to really get into Bucky in these meetups. We have done a good job of starting out, but Bucky's thought is very deep and it's very simple. It is really, as CJ pointed out, it is Bucky inspired comprehensivity. So it's all about how do you think comprehensively? So it is all about learning to think. Okay, what can you learn from Bucky about learning to think? And the best person to do that, to show us that, is Bucky himself. And fortunately, the other thing that I've noticed, and this many, many, many people who have tried to study Bucky have commented, that Bucky, for most people, is difficult reading. But also, most people who have been focused on Bucky fondly remember the first time they heard Bucky speak and how mesmerized they were and how much they got from it. And that was the reason they started to read Bucky. So he is superb, incredibly good at speaking. And there is him. You know, we are fortunate that we have this amazing collection of videos. The largest collection of it is the series called Everything I Know. It's about 42 hours. So what we're going to do, it is divided into 12 videos. So we are going to start with that in April. We are going to spend two Sundays. The task would be to choose a video. Everybody watches it. Everybody who wants watches it. And everybody gets to talk for 5 to 7 minutes on what are the key things they got from it. We have used this format before at 52 Living Ideas. It works beautifully. There will be about 12 different people on an average. Everybody is welcome to do that, regardless of your knowledge of Bucky. We are really, you're going to hear, because the average length is about, let's say, about 2 hours or so of the video. And I'm sure each of the speakers is going to bring up something that you have not thought of, because it's a very rich topic that we are covering. And I think we will ramp up fast on Bucky. So I expect to finish that. We expect to finish that in about 6 months, going through chapter by chapter. So that's what we want to do. In addition, we will have more presentations. There is a whole bunch of people that CJ recommended to us, whom I have not yet reached out to. I wanted to get us started. I wanted to show people who are not, you know, of what we have done, what we are doing, and so that they would get excited about coming on. And we will have, I'm going to add some more time slots at 1 p.m. because that works better for people from Europe. So we will have some additional presentations. So we are going deep into it, but we are going to add a very important person to the list of people whom we hear a lot from, and that's going to be Bucky himself. And I think that's going to do us good. Okay, so this is the plan. That, you know, I also today I ran it through, ran it around Rupali and Joe and Maritza, and they all think it's a great idea. But now I want to hear from you folks. Number one, how are we doing? It's been 2 months. We've done, I don't know how many, maybe about 10, 12 meetups so far in the Bucky series. How are we doing? So that's one question. And what do you think about the idea of including large amount of speaking by Bucky as an input in the meetups going forward? So please, I have my pen and paper ready. Would love to hear from as many of you as you can, both give feedback and comments on the future. We'll start with Paul. Paul, what do you think?
I love it. I'm looking forward to watching Bucky and hearing you guys. What a chance. It's fantastic. But I think in terms of other things to do, we did not answer Laura's question.
No. We are just right now.
I know, but that's my point about going forward. Okay, but it's a suggestion for going forward.
Okay.
Do you want to hear my suggestion?
Okay, sure. Very quick. Go ahead.
I thought that's what we were doing here, but maybe not.
No. We're just. I want feedback on the plan of including Bucky in,
oh, okay.
in this.
All right. I love that. I want to augment it with another idea. That's all.
Sure. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. That you told a story of the Charlie Chaplin movies. We need to apply all of Bucky's principles to find a better way to teach it.
Sure.
That's my idea in this group.
No, I love it. I love it. But let's first master Bucky's ideas. I'm telling you, I watched Bucky today and I feel ashamed that I don't get him. Okay. There is just so much depth there, so much simplicity there, so much power there. And you can't do anything until you really need to get that. You know, all of us need to get that. Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Next up is John and Yoshimi.
Okay, I want to build on what Paul said.
Okay.
Because we bought that series in 2002. I think the longest I lasted was 20 minutes listening to it. So I always fell asleep. And I love Bucky. But in 2002, we said, okay, tonight we're going to watch a half hour. One problem was, you know, we bought it in the days it was on the cassette.
BHS.
And the sound was terrible. And so the way he speaks and the sound being poor, it's very difficult. And I totally agree with Laura and Paul, because our job is not to, yes, we're inspiring each other, but we really need to look at a way to inspire the young people to understand this. You know, I bought the book Bucky for Beginners. Yes. I can't even understand that. And I'm sure I was a teacher for 8 years. And unless it was presented to me in a way that made sense, there's no way I'm going to teach it to the children. You know, I wish I had this in the 70s when I was a teacher. So I think it's great to develop these ideas with like minds, and we're like minds. But I think we are in such a critical time in history that we have to accelerate what and how we teach our kids this important information. Okay, so that's all.
Thank you. I mean, the thing is, I'll say a couple of things. I think we really need to, my reaction is exactly opposite. I mean, it's like I cannot sleep. If I start to listen to Bucky, because there is just so much going on in my mind. It's just, you know, I think it varies quite a bit. So, but what the good thing about the format that we have is that people who cannot listen will still get a lot from all of us, everybody summarizing it. And that will be a very easy way for people, because what we're trying to do is the idea of on-ramps. Bucky is very mathematical. So, and that's how his mind is. He's a combination. It's a very odd combination that he is. You know, he has very deep ideas about integrity, which he doesn't talk about explicitly much, but this kind of transcendentalism is a very deep part of him, which permeates all his thought. But in expression, he's really an engineer and a mathematical engineer. And so, for example, for somebody who's trained in that, for whom it is easy, they can see that, like, and it's like catnip, you know. So it is very. And what we are trying to do is that, because so many people will be engaging it, even if somebody doesn't really like listening to Bucky directly, they will get it from other people who will be able to express it in different way. So that's what I'm, you know, we want to focus on. About education is a very important problem, and the ability to solve that you know, the bar for that is very high. I mean, for example, my friend Rupali is doing that in, you know, every day in her school. That's a great example of what can be done. And it does require, it also is a problem, which is a very complex problem. It has to do with how to negotiate the public education system and all of that. That's not our purpose here. There, you know, I'm all for it. I think education is, I mean, it's really, really sad that these bright, curious beings end up in this, these pens, to call, you know, and end up destroying their curiosity. So it's a terrible thing. So I feel for that. Next up is going to be Richard, followed by Maritza. Richard.
Yeah, I'd like to follow on some of those previous comments as well. It's and I think the issue about the videos is an important one. And there may be some that really have to be shrunk, if you want, in a time so that, you know, we listen to a 10-minute chunk on a particular part. And maybe there's some 20-minute ones that we can
sure. Just do. Richard, so on that one, please go ahead and send me recommendations that you know, anybody, basically. I mean, really what I want to do is to give Bucky's own words in full.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so I'm not really hung up on that particular series. What I'm saying is that Bucky's videos of Bucky talking is going to be very useful as a way of grasping how he thinks. So there are going to be videos that are going to be better. So please, you or anybody else who, if you find clips that we should do, please go ahead and send it to me. I will organize it. I will try to make sure that the time is manageable and all of that. And we'll do that. Go ahead, Richard.
Yeah. And the other thing which also relates to the idea of how can there be better ways to teach Bucky? and for me, one of the underlying themes maybe in the next quarter, the next group, is to have in front of our minds this whole issue of whole to part thinking versus part to whole thinking. And it just for us to grapple with that. For example, in listening to Robert today on in the car on my way, words that trigger me, for example, in this area is when we talk about analytics. And we don't bring in the synthesis part, or that we don't recognize that analytics is trapped us into part to whole thinking, that we end up thinking we can find enough parts to add up and they will eventually equal some whole. And yet the rhetoric we use will always be the whole is more than the sum of the parts. So I think there's a real kind of message to all of us as we're listening and talking and going back and forth is, what are we doing vis-a-vis hold apart kind of thinking, and how trapped are we still in part to whole thinking?
Richard, so, I mean, you know, I really like that point because, I would say this, it's a very fundamental, because you put your finger on a really fundamental issue here, because the modern world is part-based thinking. It is saying that it is analytical, is all about dividing things up in a linear fashion and executing it. Instead of seeing how, you know, what is the whole. Now, fortunately, at 52 Living Ideas, we've been looking at many traditions, which are older traditions, from Tao Te Ching, Bhagavad Gita, Gospel of John. We've looked at thinkers like Louis Sullivan, who are integrative thinkers. All of these are integrative. You know, keep Louis Sullivan aside because he's recent, But these are at a time before the modern times, mm-hmm. where integrative thinking was the way, was the common way of thinking. And they always went from whole to part. So in that sense, Bucky is anachronistic. Bucky or Louis Sullivan are anachronistic. You know, they are, their base is transcendentalism of saying that, look, I want to understand the world as a whole. And that is very important. The truth is very important to me. And it doesn't matter what ideas I have. Truth is all that matters. I'm continuously trying to check those ideas and get to the truth. And the truth is the whole. Truth is always the whole. So that change of perspective, change of order from whole to part is, you know, from instead of from part to whole, but there is no way actually from part to whole. There is only way from whole to part. So that is a fundamental point. And if there are any other ways, one is that I would love to have you present on that at any point you want to present, and we can go ahead and keep working. And I think what will happen is that what we have found is that communicating such a thing, getting these ideas is very hard process because you have to do subtraction. You have to let go of the way you are thinking. That's the mm-hmm. only way there is going to be space for you to be thinking about it. And what we have found, for example, we did this first with Tao Te Ching. Now, Tao Te Ching, that took a while, and slowly it seeps in and people start to see it. So it's going to happen, but it will happen in a certain way. And I think Bucky is one of the best spokesmen for his own way of thinking. So I'm really looking forward to it. Go ahead, Richard.
No, I agree. It is very hard, and it's so easy to get back trapped in. And the only other thing I can say about it is that in terms of teaching, that I've been through the experience of teaching this kind of thing at a university level. And I've had the experience of being treated as a maverick, as an outcast, if you want, by students and colleagues. But when students actually took those kind of model and that kind of thinking into the practice world and tried them, and they went in with the attitude that said, there's a difference between town and gown, there's a difference between theory and reality. And so they really had a mindset that I'm only going to university really to get a credential, so then I can go out and do whatever I want to do. What happened for me on a number of occasions was that the students started to come back and say, so I tried your dumb idea and I can't believe it. It worked. And so there was also that hesitation of giving up what they thought was not going to work and letting go of it and bringing it back in with their own experiential evidence that it worked. And so that's the other thing, is how we go back and forth between the abstract, if you want, and the practice. And in some cases, when I was working with the abstract models, I could have a talk to a student and say, do you want to start at the abstract and then we'll work our way to the specifics of the case that you're dealing with? Or shall we start with the case and work it back to the abstract to make sure we haven't missed something? And then my final note, going back to what John was saying today, Robert was saying about this, you're always, you know, halfway to the goal line, or you get to the horizon and the damn thing moves. And I just finished reading an article by John Horgan that's often writes in the Scientific America, and he has transformed from saying someday we're going to solve the answer to the universe, what it is and so forth. Today he says, I don't think that that's really a good idea. I think we should leave some of the mystery there and keep approaching horizons, knowing that they're going to move on me, and they're going to move on me, and they're going to move on me. And we get comfortable with the mystery is going to remain a mystery. We're going to unlock some things, but we'll never unlock everything.
Thank you.
That's part of trying to learn from Bucky too, because I don't think Bucky was a person that said everything's going to be known, because he always had a placeholder for not only what we know, but what we don't know, and for the unknown. And he would put it in his model or his thinking so that we'd always have a piece of the unknown out there that may become known, but it may not. And I think that's what John Horgan was talking about. The may not, let it be there. It may always be a may not. Anyway, sorry about
that. No, like thank that. You. Thank you. That's wonderful. Thank you. Really, really appreciate that. Next up, Rupali, I don't know if you're around, but I would love to have you share your experience with teaching and with students, because Montessori is the best example that I know of where people have actually done, you know, people are doing this day in and day out. Rupali, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. You know, while I was listening to Richard and Laura's question too, I was thinking exactly about Montessori. And, you know, we're talking about an integrated system for education where children can think comprehensively. And true that traditional system teaches children to think linearly, and the way Maria Montessori thought about the child was about the system for education was different from the traditional system. She looked at the child itself. And just like Bucky said, you know, every child is a genius. She starts from there. And Robert mentioned, you know, how a child is different from an adult. They are thinking in a more sensorial way. They are mobile. They are not sitting. It's not natural for a child to sit for a long period of time. And that's precisely what we force the children to do. Now, if you look at a Montessori classroom, children are sprawled on the floor. They're in their natural state of physical being, which allows them to just do things naturally. And I think a couple of presenters talked about how indigenous people said, oh, that's how we think. I was presenting something, a concept to the children about learning, and my sixth grader just stood up and said, oh, you're talking about me, that's me. And the thing is, children get it. Children instinctively get what we are saying because they are so closer to the truth themselves. They're not tainted like the adults are. I also think that because Montessori system teaches from whole to parts and not from parts to whole. So if you look at a traditional system, and Richard, you said this really well, you feel that at some point, the child will get all the parts together and form a whole, but they're constantly confused as to why am I learning this? That whole never really comes together for most children. And in Montessori, you start with the whole, and the teachers start with stories. You know, today Robert started his presentation with a story. Bucky always told stories. Every lesson in Montessori starts with a historical perspective. So children know exactly where this lesson is coming from, whether they're learning about nouns or verbs or science concept or math concept. And they're learning with materials. So, you know, we saw everybody playing with triangles and tetrahedrons. That's what happens on a day-to-day basis in a Montessori classroom. So when children think about it, they just think in a holistic manner. They don't think in this linear fashion. So Maria Montessori really did a remarkable job while she designed this system for education. And Shrikant, am I going to be talking on April
2nd? Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay, awesome. I'll be presenting more on this topic. I'm going to invite some of my students to talk about it because I think they can share their experience and they can say it better than I can about how they think. And, you know, the whole idea that Maria Montessori had is a child is a worker and a creator. And if you look at children, they never sit still. They're always doing something. The adults will sit still for a long period of time, but not children. Thank you,
Rupali. Rupali will be talking about how Montessori approaches education. And actually, believe it or not, there are deep connections between Bucky's approach to education and Montessori's approach. And one of her colleagues has written some articles and papers on that. And she's going to be, Rupali will be talking about that. And that's going to be on April 2nd at, I think, 1 p.m. Eastern time. All right, next up. What I'm saying is that there is actually a lot of work that is going on, which is along the same lines as Bucky. I mean, whatever, and Montessori is a very large system, and that is actually being done. So that's a good place to start. Next up is Maritza.
Hi, I just wanted to mention for those who might struggle a little bit with the videos, so all of the videos are in the Internet Archive, but the Internet Archive also has a Buckminster Fuller Archive where they have transcripts of the videos. So if you may fall asleep or something and miss it, you can actually read it. And that's mm-hmm. very helpful. For me, I like to follow along with the video, so it's helpful. I also wanted to just say something about watching the video. So I think it's an entirely different experience to sit at home and watch the videos by yourself and then to move to the next video. When you're doing it in a setting like ours here with the 5211 ideas, you're not really watching the video for yourself. You're watching the video, but I'm going to tell you, you're going to want to watch this video twice because you'll watch it. And then when you come and we get together and we talk about it, you'll be like, wait a minute, did I actually watch this? And then you're going to have to watch it again. And you're going to find yourself more engaged the second time you're watching it, because now you have all these other voices in your head and all the different ideas or the different ways in which, because everybody is going to hear it differently. So the beauty of 52 Living Ideas is that you get a dozen, two dozen different perspectives. And that makes it a richer experience. And it actually propels your understanding in a way that you can't even imagine until you've experienced it. We've done this now, Shrikant, myself, Joe, we've gone through this at least, you know, a few times now, Rupali, Lara, you know, some of our regulars, we've done this before. And when I tell you that it's an experience that you've not yet had, if you haven't walked with us, it's, and your learning is, it's like quadrupled almost. And you will want to watch it. I know you're saying maybe you're not sure it's for you, but even if you don't watch it again, you're going to want to look at the transcripts. There's just something about watching something. And I have a bad habit, if I may, watch it two and three times before we meet, just because I'm not convinced I understood it the first time. But even still, even doing that, when we come together as a group, it just feels like it's an entirely different video from what I watched, because of the fact that just invariably somebody brings up a point that you totally missed or even just that you didn't see it that way. And it's mind blowing. And it, for yourself personally, it could be a mind-altering small little thing that just hadn't occurred to you, the view in that manner. So I just wanted to, that was my, that's just my, I'm cheerleading for the video. I think it's going to be a great thing.
Thank you, Marisa. I want to build up on that. You know, first time I saw the, you know, this, the beauty of this, when we've been doing this for ever since COVID started. But the place when it really hit me was when I was going through Tao Te Ching. You know, Tao Te Ching is a very deep work. Okay, it is certainly as deep or much deeper than Bucky, the entire philosophy of Taoism. Okay. And I love Tao Te Ching. Okay, so I would read maybe 12 different translations of the verses that we were discussing and prepare, spend a lot of time preparing for the verses. And then I would show up. And people, okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Robert. See you. And then I would show up and I would be completely blown away because, you see, it's a principle of synergy. It is all these different minds with different context, different backgrounds, different understanding, different things that catch their attention, focused on the same thing. What we are looking at is incredibly deep. No matter how much you try, you are going to get only some things. This applies to the world as such. And it also applies to Bucky's writing. The other people are going to bring in facts, bring in perspectives. It is the idea of multiple perspectives being built in. This is something that CJ talked about all the time. You're basically getting multiple perspectives on the same thing, and it will be unrecognizable, the experience of watching the same thing after you're done with the description, you know, with after the discussion. All right, next up is going to be Laura. Laura, what do you think? Laura, you're on mute. Okay, Laura, we can't hear you. Okay. Anybody else has any comments about anything? You're welcome to do that. Otherwise, I want to tell you that the next one is going to be Christopher Zeloff talking about cinematic themes, not just talking about it, but showing some of the footage. So don't miss that. We've got incredible meetups coming up tomorrow. Maritza is doing something on poetry where everybody's going to read poems about loyalty and then write poems collaboratively about betrayal. On Tuesday is the last of the analytics of Confucius, after which we are going to start off with Art of War. On Wednesday, we are going to be looking at the imposter syndrome, and we are going to be doing improv. So improv and the imposter syndrome. On Thursday, we are going through the Gospel of John. This time, Gary is doing a presentation on the concept of sickness and health in Bible, and what is the spiritual equivalence of sickness and health. On Friday, we are going back to Tao Te Ching. Everybody's going to be reading their favorite verses and talking about it. On Saturday at 5 p.m., we are going to be going through Bhagavad Gita chapter 3 and 4. And on Sunday, we are going to have Christopher Zeloff presentation. So that's the week coming up. Hope you will attend some of the meetups. Thank you very much, everybody. Good night.